This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video extends our discussion of activity-based costing and describes some of the ways that activity-based costing can be expanded to help companies above and beyond just simply determining the manufacturing overhead cost that's applied to each product. For example, activity-based costing, as you see here in the first bullet point, can be used to include items such as selling, general, and administrative costs, and those items can be applied to our products for internal reporting purposes, not for external reporting purposes. So we'll talk about that a little further on the next slide. Costs can be organized in a variety of ways to help managers to evaluate performance. So we have many slides here where we'll talk about how we can organize those costs to help managers make decisions and to help managers evaluate how they their areas, their production areas are performing. The third bullet point that you see here relates to the fact that managers do have flexibility in how they organize costs for internal reporting purposes. So we have to think of this in sort of two realms. The first that we've really been focusing on up until now has to do with generally accepted accounting principles and the idea that GAAP indicates that we have to apply direct materials, direct labor, manufacturing overhead costs to products and take those costs through inventory accounts. GAAP says we have to do that. Well, for managerial accounting purposes and for internal reporting purposes, we can do whatever we want. We do not have to follow GAAP. As long as what we're doing is ethical, we do not have to follow GAAP. We're really, what our goal is, getting to the last bullet point here, it's really to provide data for managers that will help managers to make the best decisions that they can possibly make. Let's take a look at this chart that outlines a number of different costs. And as you look at this, you'll see that we have two columns, one that relates to whether it's okay or not to include these costs in the product cost for product costing purposes, for inventory purposes, according to generally accepted accounting principles. And the last column indicates whether it's okay to allocate these costs to products for internal reporting purposes. The first three costs that you see here should look familiar: direct materials, direct labor, and manufacturing overhead. All three of those costs must be attached to and allocated to products for inventory reporting purposes and inventory costing purposes according to GAAP. However, for internal reporting purposes, we can do whatever we want with those costs. Generally, we're going to include those, as you can see here with these yes notations, but we don't have to. It's completely up to the managerial accountant. But most of the time, we are going to include those costs within the product cost for product costing purposes. Where we get to the differences between GAAP and internal reporting is in these next costs. So when you look at sales commissions, all the way down to the cost of implementing activity-based costing, those costs are all expenses. They're all expensed as incurred and taken into the income statement in the period in which they are incurred for GAAP purposes. So it's not okay, that's what you see here, it's not okay to include those or allocate those costs to products for the purposes of GAAP. However, for internal reporting purposes, we can do whatever we want. So we can take those costs and allocate them. It's okay to allocate those costs to the products that we produce for internal reporting purposes. So let me give you an example. Sales commissions. Sales commissions tend to be directly related to products that our salespeople sell. And it's a cost associated with that product. Why not then, for internal reporting purposes, take the sales commissions associated with each product and attach those costs to each product when we're evaluating the cost associated with each product? Some companies do this. The same comment could be made for shipping products to customers. Perhaps we should attach those costs to products. It's okay for internal reporting purposes, but not for GAAP. Product advertising. If we're advertising specific products, again, for GAAP purposes, we have to expense those types of costs when they're incurred, but for internal reporting purposes, it might make more sense to attach those costs to our products. So we have flexibility. I guess the point that we're trying to make here is that for managerial accounting purposes and internal reporting purposes, we have lots of flexibility in deciding which costs to allocate to products and which costs not to allocate to products. Let's take this concept a little bit further by differentiating between service departments within a company and production departments within a company, and this will lead our way into talking about how to take costs that are associated with service departments and allocate those costs to production departments. So we'll get to that in a couple of slides, but before we get to that, let's talk about the difference between service departments and production departments. Service departments are those departments, as you see here in this first bullet point, are those departments that provide services to other departments within the company. So functions like accounting, human resources, if we have legal support, or if we have a maintenance and computer support department, those are all service departments in that they all provide services to other departments. With regards to production departments, these are the departments that are directly involved with producing goods for customers, and they include things like purchasing materials, assembling products, making sure that our products are in good shape by doing quality inspections. Those are all part of the production department cost and process. Why do companies take the cost of service departments and then allocate those costs to production departments? Well, there are several reasons. First of all, the services that are provided by the service departments, they're not free. And we don't want our production departments within our company to think of those services as being free. So it would make sense then to allocate those costs, those service department costs, to the production departments. Since there is a cost, sort of an implicit cost, related to these service departments, companies want to know how much those costs are. How significant are those costs? And would it make sense maybe to outsource some of those service departments? Sometimes companies will outsource, for example, the maintenance of their buildings, or legal support. And having that service department cost information is helpful and useful in making those types of outsourcing decisions. The third reason that companies will often allocate service department costs to production departments is that organizations often want to include those service department costs when they're making decisions about their products. That really is a component of the cost of their products, even though for GAAP purposes it's not. Well, for internal reporting purposes and decision-making purposes, sometimes it does make sense to include service department costs when evaluating product costs. Here we get into the nuts and bolts of allocating service department costs to production departments. And we've got an example here that we can look at to illustrate how to do this. Realize that this is the direct method. This is one of several methods that can be used to allocate service department costs to production departments. So we'll talk about this one. More advanced courses get into other possible methods. We're going to go back to SaleRight. We've used SaleRight in some of our other videos as an example. And we're going to allocate the service departments that you see down here at the bottom related to human resources and computer support. We're going to allocate the costs associated with each of those departments, which, by the way, is $90,000 for the human resource department and $150,000 for the computer support department. We're going to allocate those costs to the production departments that you see here, the hull fabrication department and the assembly department. How do we do that? Well, there are lots of different ways to do this, but this company, with SaleRight, we've chosen to allocate the human resource costs, the $90,000, based on the number of employees within each of these production departments. And we're going to allocate our computer support costs based on the number of computers within each of the production departments. So to do this fairly quickly, but to give you an idea of how this works, we have $90,000 that you see right here for the human resource department. Those are the costs that we need to allocate to these two production departments. We're going to allocate that $90,000 out based on the number of employees that each of these production departments has. So $90,000, the best way to do this is to take $90,000 and divide it by the total number of employees for those two departments, and that's going to give us a rate that we will use to allocate these costs. And that rate works out to $750 per employee. I'll abbreviate employee here, but per employee. Once we have that rate of $750 per employee, we'll multiply that by the number of employees in each department. So $750 times 35 employees in the hull fabrication department gives us a total dollar amount of $26,250. and that's the amount of the Human Resource Service Department total cost of $90,000. That's the portion that is then allocated to the whole fabrication department. We do the same math for assembly, take $750 times the 85 employees that are in assembly, and that gives us a dollar amount of $63,750 that is being allocated to the assembly department. We do the same thing for the computer support department. Take the $150,000, divide it by the 75 computers that you see here, and that gives us the rate. Multiply the rate times the number of computers for each department, and then that gives us the dollar amount that's allocated from computer support to each of those departments. Since this video is focusing on a number of different ways of organizing costs for a variety of decision-making purposes, we're going to talk about this concept of hierarchy of costs. What is this concept of the hierarchy of costs? Well, they're costs that are grouped into four different categories, and those four categories are outlined down below here. The next slide will give us more information on these categories, so I'll just do this briefly here. There are four groups. We have the facility level of costs, the product or customer level of costs, batch level of costs, and unit level of costs. We'll define each of those four categories here, and then on the next slide we can take a look at some examples. Facility level activities, what you see here, facility level activities are required to sustain the overall facility operations. The product level activities are required to develop, produce, and sell certain types of products. Remember, this also could relate to customers. Batch level activities are required to produce batches of products. And again, we'll get some examples on the next slide. And unit level activities are required to produce individual units of product. Here's a chart that has examples for each of the four categories in the cost hierarchy. Facility level costs. What are some examples of facility level costs? Well, plant depreciation, depreciation on the factory is in this category, along with rent for the factory and managing the factory. Those are all facility level costs. Product or customer level costs would include new product development, going out and developing the next greatest iPhone, for example. Product engineering related to that iPhone and any marketing or advertising related to that, as well as maintaining customer records if it's a customer kind of a service type of a company. Those all relate to product and customer level types of costs. Then we get into batch level costs, and here we're talking about things like machine setups where we would set up a particular machine to produce one type of product, processing purchase orders for batches of products that we're going to be producing, and any quality inspections. Let's say that we have a batch of products that has come through production and now we want to inspect those products. That would be those inspection costs would be a batch level cost. And lastly, we have unit level costs. So energy to run production machines, direct labor, the ones that we really talk the most about are direct labor and direct materials. Those are very closely associated with each unit of product that we are producing. So those are unit level costs. Think of the cost hierarchy as a framework for managers to establish cost pools and to figure out what drives the change in costs for each of those cost pools. So it's really helpful when we're establishing an activity-based costing system, for example, to look at all of our costs in this framework. We're going to stick with the theme of this video that costs can be organized in a number of different ways to help managers. Now we're going to focus on how costs can be organized to assess quality. There are four different categories that we can use to assess the quality of the products that we're producing, and we call these, by the way, the cost of quality. And you've got the categories here in the first column: prevention costs, appraisal costs, internal failure costs, and external failure costs. And they're fairly descriptive, those titles. So prevention costs are those costs that of activities that we incur to prevent problems with our products, so defects in our products, for example. These costs would be for quality training. Maybe we're training our personnel to inspect the raw materials to make sure that they are of the appropriate quality, that we don't have defective products as a result of those bad raw materials. The appraisals, those are prevention costs. The appraisal costs are the cost of activities to detect defective products. So think back, prevention costs are really useful because if we are doing this correctly, we're putting this money into training and things that will prevent defects in our products. Appraisal costs, on the other hand, we're trying to detect defective products. So it's after we've already produced some defective products, but now we're trying to figure out, do we have any defective products out there? So things like inspecting finished goods would be an appraisal cost. Internal failure cost is when we do detect defective products, but we do that before those products get out to the customer. So, for example, we may go in and in the appraisal cost process, find that in finished goods inspections that we have bad product. The internal failure cost would be having to rework or to scrap those products. External failure costs are those related to identifying defective products once they've reached the customer. And this is kind of the worst scenario where we have those products coming back in and we incur, for example, warranty repair costs or when we have to replace those products. Those would fall under the external failure cost category. So how do managers use the cost of quality to improve operations? Well, first of all, managers will review those costs in those four categories, and they'll look at it not just as a whole, but also as a percent of total revenue. And they'll look at that over time to kind of get a sense of what's happening with those four different costs of quality as they relate to total revenue. And the goal is to steadily shift the costs more toward prevention and appraisal and away from internal, should have also external in here, internal and external failure categories. So we want to see those costs go more toward prevention and appraisal and away from internal and external failure categories. And then lastly, hopefully if this is all done correctly, product quality improves and the total quality costs will go down over time because we are shifting our emphasis to prevention and trying to cut off those defects before they ever make it to our finished goods inspections and to our customers. So in the long term, our goal is to improve the product, improve the quality, and decrease the costs that are associated with defects.